16th Avenue.
I gave her her first drink of liquor and the first cigarette. As she smoked, and I was the first one to kiss.
Are you gonna pick and sing for us, baby? Oh, how you been, Owen? Come on, Owen, buy us all one. You make plenty of money on this road.
I've had a dollar with that. There's been lots of men since me. There'll be many more, I suppose. Hearts that are ripe for the breaking, but mine was the first heart she broke. Yes, mine was the first, not the second.
Come down here and you get to drinking, you know, and you get broke, all right? You got to have money if you're coming to Nashville to make it in music.
You know,
I've got a lot of studios around here that loan me money every once in a while and help me get a place to stay, you know. Right now I'm sleeping in my car out back. But I am going to stay here until I either make it or die.
And that's a fact. All right.
Broken bottles in the alley, broken dreams among the shadows, the blood bank every Wednesday pays for 48 more hours near the mission there on 7th, where he never thought he'd be. On the other side of Nashville, Tennessee.
There was a time when talent may have been enough for a musician to make it in Nashville. But now the music business is a hit factory with millions of dollars at stake. The musicians, songwriters, and producers have turned into poker players, gambling their lives on the music, and Nashville is the casino they play in. Some come in just to play a few hands, some spend their lives at the table. Some win, some lose. Once in a while, a gambler walks into the casino and breaks the bank. But the casino never lost and never will. And what does it all mean? We've seen them laugh, we've seen them cry, we've seen them live, and we've seen them die. But what would a gambler be without a casino?
We're in a gambling business. This whole business really is a crapshoot. You spend thousands and thousands and thousands of dollars to do records, never knowing whether half the time they'll even be sold to a company. You may eat it, But then again, you may come up with that thing that sells 3-4 million singles, and you're an overnight success after 25 years in the business, you know.
On a warm summer's evening, on a train bound for nowhere, I met up with a gambler. We were both too tired to sleep, so we took turns of staring out the window at the darkness till boredom overtook us, and he began to speak. He said, son, I've made a life out of reading people's faces and knowing what the cards were by the way they held their eyes. So if you don't mind my saying, I can see you're out of aces. For a taste of your whiskey, I'll give you some advice. So I handed him my bottle, and he drank down my last swallow. Then he bummed a cigarette and asked me for a light. And the night got deathly quiet, and his face lost all expression. Said, if you're gonna play the game, boy, you gotta learn to play it right.
But he comes from abject poverty, eight kids living in a room with a father who never, the most money ever made in a week was $60. And he went from that to one of the most successful people in the world. And that's that American dream that we've talked about, or the dream of anyone around the world, to break through under difficult circumstances.
Every gambler knows that the secret to surviving is knowing what to throw away, knowing what to keep, 'cause every hand's a winner and every hand's a loser. The best that you can hope for is to die in your sleep. And when he finished speaking, he turned back toward the window, crushed out a cigarette, faded off to sleep. And somewhere in the darkness, the gambler, he broke even. But in his final words, I found an ace that I could keep. You got to know when to hold up, know when to fold up, know when to walk away, and know when to run. You never count your money when you're sitting at the table. There'll be time enough for counting when the dealing's done. You got to know when to hold up,
when to hold up,
know when to fold up, know when to walk away, and know when to run. You never count your money when you're sitting at the table. There'll be time enough for counting when the dealing's done. You got to know when to hold up, know when to fold up, know when to walk away, and know when to run. You never count your money when you're sitting at the table. There'll be time enough.
The basic country singer was poor, and they found a way through country music to get out of this poverty and better themselves and get attention. And that's the way it has been, you know, with the people that I have been through the years with in country music.
Back when Nashville was just another southern town where people printed Bibles and sold insurance, country music was only for country people, and they played it for fun, not for a living. Then in 1925, the National Life and Accident Insurance Company put up a 50,000-watt radio station to advertise insurance on the air. The announcer liked hillbilly music, so he asked some fiddlers and banjo pickers to come to Nashville and play between commercials. And soon, their music could be heard from Texas to Canada. The show was called the Grand Ole Opry, and more musicians started coming and coming. Around then, the big record companies up north figured hillbilly music could sell. So their talent scouts signed Jimmy Rogers, who'd learned the blues from black train men in Mississippi. and the Carter family, who played Appalachian mountain music. They brought them to New York to record and advertise their tunes through the Sears and Roebuck catalog, and the country music industry was born. When the Great Depression came along, country folks moved into the cities and brought their music with them, and it kept growing. The advent of jukeboxes and the Second World War spread their music to people who'd never heard it before. After the war, the GIs and their families swarmed to Nashville to see the Opry, that by then had moved to the Ryman Auditorium. The Ryman was to give birth to such superstars as Roy Acuff, Ernest Tubb, Hank Williams, George Jones, Marty Robbins, Patsy Cline, Loretta Lynn, and many, many more. Then the record companies decided it would be cheaper and faster to record in Nashville. And early pioneers like Paul Coyne and Stephen Scholes started building studios there with the help of musicians like Chet Atkins and Owen Bradley, who created the Nashville sound by adding strings, vocals, and echo chambers to the recordings. Country music had become a million-dollar industry. But that today is history. Now country music is a billion-dollar industry. Nashville grew from 3 to 60 recording studios with thousands of musicians, hundreds of publishers and talent agencies sharing the profits. The Opry has moved from the old Ryman Auditorium to Opryland, a $28 million entertainment complex housing the world's largest television studio that broadcasted shows to 7 million homes every day. Opryland attracts 2 million tourists a year, and WSM, the radio station that started it all, now broadcasts country music nationwide by satellite.
Cause hell broke loose in Georgia and the devil deals a card. If you win, you get this shiny fiddle made of gold. But if you lose, the devil gets your soul. Made an evil hit. And a band of demons joined in, and it sounded something like this.
Country music is now programmed on 2,000 and more radio stations each day, as compared to 81 radio stations in 1961. The name Nashville has become a household word actually around the world.
Kin folks are coming, they're coming by the dozen, eating everything from soup to hay. And right after dinner, they ain't looking any thinner. And here's what you'll hear them say. Y'all come, y'all come. Oh, you all come to see us when you can.
The recording companies, all the majors, now practically insist that you have a fleet of attorneys, a manager, a booking agent, somebody to handle your merchandising, and so on and so forth. I think that the industry has changed so because the dollars have grown so in our business.
The people who now are in control of country music are the people who have come here, who have mapped out their plans of selling this product. And it has to do with flash and TV and...
It's an industry.
It's an industry, and it's become something that's far removed from the working man and the people that it's really supposed to be about.
When I went there back in 65, they already were, they thought at the time that I was like 8 years too late. because music, I mean, the industry had grown so much in 8 years then that it wasn't as easy to make it.
Oh, you all come to see us when you can. Y'all come, y'all come. Oh, you all come to see us now and then. Oh, you all come to see us now and then.
There were people long before I came along that realized that this was the music of America, this was the music of our roots, and that it would be widely accepted if it were marketed properly, and some good marketing people got into the picture and started doing a job. And the country music industry has some of the best marketing people in the world. Country music was there 50 years ago, but nobody was marketing it.
When I first started having hit records, I traveled in I had a Cadillac and a U-Haul trailer, and that's how me and the band traveled. And there wasn't that many places to work, you know, because country music wasn't accepted that much then. Now I travel in an air-conditioned bus with video cassette players and microwave ovens, and now there's many places to work. I mean, I have worked every town in the United States.
Headache calm in the breeze. I keep blowing down the road. Headache calm in the breeze. I keep blowing down the road, yeah, dude. I ain't got me nobody. I ain't carrying me no load.
When you're on the bus,
now,
this thing right here holds about 4 cases of beer, and we got another thing that holds more. And there's a lot of beer drunk on this bus, I tell you that. And then it's sleepy time. There's about 2 cases of beer.
I might go out to California, might go down to Georgia to my home.
It gets lonesome, you know, you get to sit around motels or here and you get homesick, but that's what I do. I'm too lazy to work, and as they say, too nervous to steal. So I take my guitar and pick and sing every night.
I ain't hiding from nobody, I ain't carrying me no load.
When I started, it was a small operation. There wasn't that many people doing it, and there was a small clique of talented, creative people around. But since then, it's evolved into such a big operation that it's mind-boggling. You can't, there's a lot of things you can and cannot do now.
But I go back now, it's the Opry now isn't the old Opry House. You know, back when we were there, it was the old Ryman Auditorium where Hank Williams had sung. And there was Tootsie's Orchid Lounge, the little beer hall, where where all these guys had drunk beer, you know, and Hank Williams had probably written a song there, you know. And now it's Opryland. It's like Disneyland.
Every year I think, well, it'll level off and it won't get any bigger, but every year seems like it gets bigger and bigger, and that's been happening since 1955 or six, so who knows? I think it's already a big television center here, great television facilities, and movies, I guess, will be next and things like that. But it keeps getting bigger and bigger, and who knows where it'll stop. I hope it never stops. I hope it continues to be a great music center, and I think it will as long as we don't conform too much. There's too much conformity in the music business today, and you don't survive doing that.
Originally, when country music was called country music, it was maybe back in the 30s and the 40s when people like Jimmy Rogers and people like Hank Williams, they played songs that they felt, they wrote songs about tragedies of the South and the East. I think a lot of country music audiences and a lot of country music fans really want to see it go back to the older traditional roots because a lot of the young kids have never heard that.
Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome epic recording artist Ricky Skaggs.
A gal that's sweet to me, and she just ain't what she used to be. She's just a little high-headed, and that's plain to see. Don't get above your razor, stay down to earth with me. Now look at her gal, she high-headed me. I ain't forgot what she used to be. When you didn't have nothing, that's plain to see. Don't get above your razor, stay down to earth with me. Every time you pass me by, cause it don't mean nothing to me, you see. Now get above your razor, stay down to earth with me. Now look at her, gal, you better be yourself and leave that other stuff on the shelf, cause you're a country baby, and that's plain to see. Now get above your razor, stay down to earth with me.
The reason bluegrass never got really any bigger than what it had is because it wasn't really commercially acceptable. It wasn't competitive. The beat wasn't strong enough. The singing was real, real high, maybe real nasally, and that maybe turned a lot of people off to it. But yet the picking and the fire in it, you know, always turned people on. Fans out there are supporting me in what I'm doing, trying to bring the old traditional country sounds back to a country music industry that has gone so pop and so widely away from the old traditional roots that a lot of people don't know what it is.
A lot of the young people are now listening to country music that were into
Elvis Presley and Bob Dylan and the Beatles and before, and their children now are into country music, and I think the numbers and the energy from the young people is what's made not only my career zoom on up there, but a lot of other people's.
Artists, in the majority, are younger thinking. They're looking toward possibly the pop market, not necessarily recording the pop record, but the crossover record. Consequently, the songwriters are writing more in that pop area, still palatable to the country marketplace. They have not exiled anyone who likes good stone country records. But I think the caliber of songwriter, the caliber of singer, and the musicians are all younger. And I think that helps.
Being part of the 60s generation that was affected by the country rock, I'm lean very much towards that. I think that even when I cut old standards like I'll Be There or It's a Lovely World, it has a more contemporary feel to it. It doesn't sound traditional, even though they are traditional songs, and I try to treat them in a respectful way. But I think it's a much younger sound. I think it appeals to a younger audience. At first, when I went into the studio as a producer, it was very difficult for a lot of the men to accept because it hadn't been done. And even more than being a woman, it was hard for people here to accept an artist producing themselves, because there aren't very many artists in Nashville that have production control. The only thing I've really learned in doing all this is there isn't a right and a wrong way. There's my way and there's the rest of the world's way. And if I do it my way, then it's mine. And if I do it their way, then it's theirs.
Yeah. Ken.
Yeah, Rick.
Hey, John, listen to this.
No, you're fine. Yeah, that'll work.
Stay loose, because there's a lot of cuts.
All right, here we go.
Five, four, three,
two, one, pick.
I don't need your hard-earned money.
Start there about 3 seconds.
Tony, I got money of my own.
That's good.
I don't need your helpful instructions to help me get to where I'm going. I don't need you to drive me downtown in your big shiny car. My needs are simple. If you just sit down, I'm gonna tell you what they are.
People say what we need is more train songs, but we don't ride on trains anymore, so it doesn't make any sense. It's great to sing the old train songs, but, you know, it's kind of silly for me to try to write a song about a train when there aren't any trains anymore, really, you know, operating in this country. So what you wind up writing about are the things that we're influenced and affected by.
Opryland Complex facility in Nashville, Tennessee. This is the Music Country Network, and this is Chuck Morgan
And we want to welcome to our studios
one of the great new artists in country music, Terry Gibbs. Terry, I've got to ask you, what is country music to Terry Gibbs?
Country music is very deep feeling kind of music. And of course, country music's changed a lot in the last few years. My style of singing is kind of bluesy, and I think that fits with country music. I think that it seems to me they said that the night that the Grand Ole Opry was named the Grand Ole Opry, that there was a blues harmonica player.
D. Ford Bailey.
Yeah, playing on Opry that night, and it's hard to really answer that question.
Everybody thinks that they've got an answer for what country music is, and I don't think that anybody can say what country music is, because there's as many different types of country as there are states in the United States. You can't just say country music.
When you see me in misery, come on, baby, see about me. Great this evening. I want to ask all of you if you would to help me out in this next verse. I want everybody out there to put your hands together on this next one and repeat after me. I want everybody out there to do it. Come on.
Country music is not what it used to be, you know. It's it has changed a lot, and there's a lot of bad country music out there, like there is in any other music. But there's enough good things to help us make it and help the music stay popular, I think.
I think we are enjoying quite a surge and quite an emergence of international fame for country music product, and therefore the artists reap the benefits and the record labels reap the benefits and all that. But the word commercial is not a derogatory term. It really isn't. If something's not commercial, that means it's not selling. It means it's not going to do well. So I think it's rather a positive term.
The industry is a machine. I mean, it is a machinery. But just as the machinery handles mediocre music and makes it a hit, it can handle the good music and make it a hit, too. The machinery can't tell the difference between good and bad, so it's all up to us. It's all up to the artists, the singers, to the writers, to the creators, you know, to keep creating the good music and get it to the people.
Sweeping out a warehouse in West LA, but it's all alright.
describe myself as a country artist. If somebody said, what do you want to be when you grow up, little girl? No, I would say, I want to be a country singer. I want to be a country artist because country is my first love. And even though I may dabble here and there and go a little left field every once in a while, basically I'm always going to come back to your three chord country song, which I love better than anything when it comes to music. That's my staple. That's my meat and potatoes, and that's what I'll always come back to.
1,500 miles from the people I know.
Being successful is the ultimate in music. I come from a purist school where I used to think that if you were successful, you must be doing something wrong. You know, back in the days when, you know, music had to be so pure and so left field that, that if you were successful, you must be selling out.
I got a 69 Chevy with a 396. You leave heaven and earth on the floor. She's waiting. Outside the 7-Eleven store, me and my partner, son, he built her straight out of scratch, and he rides me from town to town. We only run for the money, got no strings attached. We shut him up and then we shut him.
I'm a singer, so first I go for the song. And all I do is listen to the lyrics. And if you listen to the lyrics of the couple of Bruce Springsteen songs I've done, especially Racing the Streets, they're in their attitude and in their style, their country, in a sense, they're simple, they tell a story. Sometimes you have to look outside. Sometimes you get too close to something, you know. Maybe the country people who are supposed to be writing country are too locked into it and can't see the forest for the trees, so you go out to somebody who's a rock writer and get something and just do it in your own style and you make it into a country song. Or maybe it's just my refusal to accept the fact that, you know, I want to do any song that I want to sing, I'll find a way to do it.
Another
I don't think country music is confined to Nashville anymore. I mean, a long time ago that was true, but it broke out from Nashville a long time ago with Graham and the Burrito Brothers and with Willie and Waylon, you know, and Texas. And I mean, I remember going on tour and in places like Cincinnati, finding these fanatical country fans. I mean, and these little bands playing, country bands playing.
It used to appeal only to poor Southern working whites. Now it appeals to people all over the world and from all walks of life. And I think the reason is that it has kind of lost its identity. It's become more urbanized, more influenced by the pop field, by rhythm and blues, by jazz and everything. They've borrowed from us also. So now you've got mostly one music. It's not all that country, but it's pretty pop, and it appeals to city audiences, and that's the reason for the great success of country music today.
I think country music, at the point it is right now, is quickly losing its identity, and it'll probably wind up eventually somewhere down the road fragmented into, like, there are different types of country. Like, there will be bluegrass here, traditional country there, crossover country, pop country here, then it'll come and it'll go.
Ah, oh, there it is, great.
Goodbye to a river, goodbye to the trees, goodbye to the night birds, just sing in the breeze.
The music is really love, you know, and you play it for that, but then at some point when you decide that you will no longer hold tobacco or chop cotton or whatever, then you start pursuing music as a monetary career. And at that point, like, the innocence of the music made it like love, but now the music has become a commodity, like toothpaste or Tide or whatever's popular at the time. Now we've got into all these frills and these Broadway and these people that come here who don't know the suffering and the working man's part of country music.
Love you in springtime when the wildflowers bloom. And I love your summer skies and this big yellow moon. I love you in autumn and when the whippoorwills call. I love your people most of all. Goodbye to a river, goodbye to the trees, goodbye to the night birds that sing in the breeze. They're building a dam, it's too late to cry. Fras or stadio, adios, goodbye.
It's what's real and it's what's happening. Like, we don't have to get dressed up in sequins and hire a makeup artist and all that sort of stuff to do what we're doing. I mean, it's the music of the people. We have to play to the people. We have to play what's happening right now.
Night after night, I sit and sip my drink by candlelight. Since you went away, I'm sitting in that blue flame cafe. The waiter walks by, and I give him the blame. He fills up my glass, and she's going past. Since you went away, I'm sitting in that blue flame.
The blues in my life came from being involved with black people working in the fields with me. My father's a tobacco farmer. I grew up in West Tennessee here, and we have several generations of tobacco farmers, and they're like Like, that is work for survival that requires the hands and the back and the, you know, the part of the person that has to really work. And from that comes the blues.
Where I can reminisce and be all alone since you went away. I'm sending that blue flame cafe. I'm lonely in the blue flame cafe.
Country music is the music of the working people of America, just as black music is the music of the working people of America, the blue-collar people. That's where it all began. It is the roots, and it's all of our roots.
I think probably that one of the big things about growing up in the part of the country that I grew up in was to a real respect and a real love for the laboring class, for the blue-collar people, the farmers and carpenters and the plumbers and the people that make their living with their hands, because that was the people I was associated with. It was a very prejudiced society at the time. I'm not trying to make excuses when I say it, but the truth is we really didn't know any better. It's something that had been passed down in my part of the country for an awful long time, and as it opened up and as people started learning a little more about each other, things lightened up a whole lot. I did a lot of traveling and found out a lot about other people and changed a lot of my ideas.
Thank you for coming. Hi.
Elaine Brinkley.
Elaine, thank you for coming.
Thank you.
All right. How you doing, partner?
Well, the reason I use a black choir on stage is because I love black gospel music. I always have. I think most anybody that was born in the South during my time had a lot of contact with and a lot of love for black gospel music.
I sing Amazing Grace.
Very much down to earth and spoke in layman's language. The performance is done with a lot of fervor. Gospel music is supposed to be happy. If you're praising the Lord, you're supposed to be happy, and black gospel music just says it all.
Undertaker, please drive slow. Cause that lady, she was hollering, Lord, I hate to see her go.
You're the sidewalk, beautiful man, by and by, by and by.
behind her. Try to hold up and be brave, but I could not hide my sorrow when they laid her in the grave. Will the circle be unbroken?
I think there's a lot more black influence in country music than a lot of people would think. I can't cite any examples, but I hear it in there. I hear blues in Bill Monroe's bluegrass music. I hear blues in Roy Acuff's music from out of the mountains. I hear blues in most of the original country music. Jimmy Rogers, the blue yodeler, sang a lot of blues.
The rhythm that the black people have in the South, where I grew up, that give me that old-time religion, something that old-time religion. It fits so well with, yeah, my bucket's got a hole in it. It touched people like the man that wrote that song, Hank Williams. I mean, he was saying things that like in 1948, 9, Hank Williams was saying, going down to the river, see the crabs and the fishes doing the bebop beep. Nobody had ever heard, what was bebop, you know? Hank must have known.
He was taught by a black street singer in Montgomery, Alabama to play guitar. And the man's name was T-Tot. Daddy hung around him all the time. He called him Little White Boss. He said, "Why are you hanging around me, Little White Boss?" He said, I like that guitar. And he showed him how to play, and it was the real hard drive and, you know, really banging it. Like a hey good looking dun 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 dun. You know, it was, they said, "Hey, what's this guy?" You know, it don't sound like Bill Monroe to me.
I'm about to
pick up my tape book over the fence and buy me one for 5 or 10 cents. I'll keep it till it's covered with hay. While I'm writing your name down, I'll never pay. Say, hey, good looking. Why you got cooking?
He was one of the first guys that had a pretty hard, definite beat. That's why he's so loved and respected by people in pop or rock or whatever you want to call it. Because he was one of the first rockabillies, moving the legs around and all that. When he came to town, you know, they said, hey, we can't have this on the Grand Ole Opry.
When Hank Williams came to the Grand Ole Opry in 1949, he was already the best-known country entertainer in America. But he also had a problem with the bottle. He started missing shows, and after 2 years, he was kicked out of the Opry for drinking. On New Year's Day of 1953, he died in the back seat of a limousine, somewhere in West Virginia, on his way to a concert.
Dead when he was 29 and I was 3. It was fun to be Hank Williams Jr. when you was a kid on Ed Sullivan at 14, but it was hell later on. But, you know, I was never gonna change my name or anything. Some people wanted to do that, and I said, no way I'd ever do that. Makes it more challenging.
Well, Hank Jr. was just a little kid. He was only 16 when I went there. As I remember, he was still doing what his mama had him programmed to do, you know? He was singing with the cheating hearts and wearing his daddy's clothes. And handling it pretty good for a kid. They would try and shoot him down in interviews, you know? And one guy tried to bust him for imitating his father. Said, asked him if he could explain how come he sounded so much like his daddy's records or some dumb thing like this. And this kid said, well, do you think it might have something to do with heredity? I thought, well, you're all right.
Hey, good looking. What you got cooking? How about cooking something up with me? You say, hey, sweet baby, don't you think, baby, we can find us a brand new recipe? Hey, babe, I got a hot rod Ford and $2 bill. I got a King Air that goes to Jacksonville. Got soda pop and a dancing free. You want to party hard and drop the needle on both feet, but say, hey.
I don't have to explain it to you. You take the name Hank Williams Jr. and say he's going to have 8 albums on the Billboard charts. You tell him that in 1974 or 5 and say, what? No way. You must be crazy. That was the challenge. That's like saying John Wayne Jr. is going to make as many movies as his father did, you know. Hard to believe.
Hank Jr. has become his own legend. For years, his mother tried to make him a carbon copy of the father Hank had barely known. Fame came easy, and so did the booze and the women. Until Hank decided to step out of his father's shadow and go find his own way. And just when he was about to get there, he fell off a mountain and damn near killed himself. He survived by a miracle and went on to have more albums on the charts at one time than any other country star in history. Now touring with his Bama band, he opens his shows by singing, you ain't gonna call Hank Jr. Jr. anymore.
I play what I want to play. Some of it's country, some of it's black blues, some of it's kind of like old rock and roll or whatever. Some of it's piano. But all of it gets a point across usually.
Though you cannot see him, he's there just the same. Though you cannot see him, he's there just the same. Taking care of business is his middle name.
This guy asked me, you know, I had the operations and fell off the mountain and all of that. He said, did you ever have any doubt in your mind? I said, well, almost a few times. Especially when you ain't got no gums or teeth or anything to sing with, you know, it's kind of rough. And Merle, talking about confidence, said, oh yeah, oh yeah. He had said his father had it too. He was a very confident person. I'm a very confident person.
I think it's an accident that guys like Jerry Lee Lewis and Hank Williams grew up so black influenced, because the soul that come out in black music comes out in their music.
In Manchester, Tennessee, 60 miles from Nashville, at night you could hear two radio stations, WSM in Nashville and WLAC in Nashville. And on WSM you heard country music at night, and on LAC you heard R&B, real, what they call back in the 50s, race music. Most of my contemporaries today grew up on that music. They got a dose of each, the rhythm and blues and the country music, from those two powerhouse radio stations that covered the entire Southeast at night.
I liked Little Richard and Fats Domino, Jerry Lee Lewis, Chuck Berry. More of the black artists, because, well, that was the rock and roll.
I worked in the cotton fields with the black people, and I listened to songs like, "We'll go and lay down my burden on home," and that humming and that rhythm that they had. And then I'd go home, and my dad only listened to country music. I remember very well, I'd sit around doing the Wabash Cannonball that Roy Cuff had. But I was doing, "Well, from the great Atlantic Ocean to the wide Pacific shore." He said, "That ain't right, boy." He He said, that ain't the way they do it. I said, Daddy, that's the way I feel it. I call it feel-good music. And then somewhere in the early 50s, somebody got to calling us rockabillies. Elvis was the first white boy on the Sun label, and I was the second one. Johnny Cash was third, and then probably Jerry Lee Lewis.
Well, I'm sitting here wondering, bad spot for my clothes. Yeah, I'm sitting here wondering.
The dust was flying. The kids were feeling that beat. We none knew exactly what was happening other than we knew we were moving the audience with what we were doing.
And suddenly, rock and roll, which had a very sexual connotation as well, hit with the young American public.
Nashville didn't like the rockabillies, but the kids loved it. For the first time, the kids had money too, and so they bought the records, and business had to follow.
Well, let me be your little dog till your big dog comes. Let me be your little dog till your big dog comes. When the big dog gets here, show him what this little puppy done. Well, I'm sitting here wondering, man, what hold my clothes. I got no matches, got a long way to go.
All of this was freedom. It's like when Presley was on Ed Sullivan's show and he couldn't move. It couldn't show him from the waist down. And all the kids knew he was moving, and they all started moving, and he moved that finger and he moved an entire world.
I ain't got no matches, got a long way to go.
I was playing a club in my hometown, and I heard a boy tell a girl, he said, don't step on my suede. And I looked down, and she had stepped on the toe of his suede. And it destroyed me, because she was so pretty. I thought, I gotta do something with this. And it's about 3 o'clock in the morning. I'd been laying there in the bed thinking, don't step on my blue suede shoes. I thought of the old nursery rhyme, one for the money, two for the show, three get ready, and four to go. And I said, one for the money, dum, dum. I jumped out of that bed, I hit them concrete steps, and I had that old guitar out of that case downstairs in about 2 seconds. I couldn't find anything to write on. I took three Irish potatoes out of a brown paper sack, and I started with a pencil. I couldn't spell suede. It was spelled, the original words were spelled S-W-A-D-E. I said, one for the money, dun, dun, two for the show, dun, dun, three to get ready, now go, cat, go, but don't you step on my blue suede shoe. My wife came to the top of the steps. She said, Carl, you're gonna wake up our babies.
It's a one for the money, honey, two for the show, three to get it ready, now go, cat, go, but don't you step on my blue suede shoe.
Hell, Carl Perkins didn't just wake up the babies, he woke up the world.
You can knock me down and step in my face, slander my name all over the place, and do anything you want to do, but our children lay off of them shoes, and don't you step on my blue suede shoe. You can do anything but lay off of my blue suede shoe. All right. Car, drink my liquor from an old fruit jar, do anything you want to do, but till I lay off of them shoes, and don't you step on my blue suede shoes. You can do anything but lay off of my cotton picking shoes. All right, blue suede my blue suede shoes. Let's rock it just one more time. Blue, blue, a blue suede shoes. Blue, blue, a blue suede shoes. Blue, blue, a blue suede shoes, baby. Blue, blue, a blue suede shoes. Do anything but lay off of my blue suede shoes.
I wrote a song called Honey Don't. I was really surprised in 1964. I went across to England, and a boy by the name of Ringo Starr said, Mr. Perkins, I sure would love to record one of your songs. I said, well, Hoss, you want me to write you one, or have I got one good enough now? He said, I like Honey Don't. And with that, George Harrison did this to his guitar. And history was made.
Well, it's a how come you say you will when you won't. Tell me that you do, baby, when you don't. Put your arms around me, let me know how it feels. Tell the truth, now is a lover real? But honey, don't. In town, uh-huh, baby, been slipping around, but honey, don't.
I was invited to do the Grand Ole Opry, and we, I will never forget, we pulled up with our bass fiddle tied on top of the old car, and the drums in the trunk, and we started in the back door, and the guard said, you can't bring those drums in here. I had to sing Blue Suede Shoes without drums, and it's pretty sick without the beat, I'll tell you. People looked down at rockabilly at the very beginning. They felt we were kind of treading on them. I know we were put on shows with people like Hank Snow, Ernest Tubb, Hank Thompson. And because our rockabilly records were starting to play, there was a lot of young kids started mixing in with the country audience.
Yes, say you will.
Beatles and the Rolling Stones were greatly influenced by the music the Rockabillys had created by bringing country music and the blues into one sound. And without artists like Carl Perkins and Little Richard and Elvis Presley, British rock and roll may never have shattered the world.
Elvis Presley almost put us out of business because every country singer thought that he had to sing rock and roll. He thought that he had to have the triplets on the piano and a lot of screaming and yelling like rock and roll. And that's, we couldn't do anything that way. We finally just buckled down and made great country records, and we had a lot of success.
Well, I was a long-haired, sideburned rockabilly from Memphis. That school of Elvis and Carl Perkins and Roy Orbison and Jerry Lee Lewis and that whole bunch, that's how I was associated in Nashville. My manager, who's Bob Neal, who was managing Elvis at the beginning, wanted to get me on the Grand Ole Opry, and of course this was my dream, you know, to be on the Grand Ole Opry. So he took me to Nashville, and the manager of the Grand Ole Opry said, what makes you think you belong on the Grand Ole Opry? And I counted to 10 and took my time, and I said, I have a number one country record and I think the fans would like to see me. And he said yes. After a little while, he said yes. He's the big boss, you know. When Jim Denny approved me coming to the Opry, I found open arms from Minnie Pearl and Ernest and Roy Cuff. All these people really befriended me. I was still called, up until the 60s, I was called a rockabilly. It was not a mark of really pride nor shame. It's just a category they tried to put me in, and I kept saying, you put me in a bag, I'm going to break out of it. And I did that with I Walked the Line. It got great acceptance in the pop field. I had an appearance one night where I don't remember what I was upset about. I'd just probably been up too long. And there's a row of 50 lights across the front of the stage of the Grand Ole Opry. I took my microphone stand and broke all of them. You know, just walked across the stage, dragging my mic stand, broke all the lights. And after that appearance, the manager of the Grand Ole Opry came up to me and said, I don't think we can use you anymore. I had been with a producer named Don Law since 58 until 1967. Bob Johnston came along, and he asked me what I wanted to do. And I said, I've always wanted to go to a prison and record an album with that live reaction and response to my songs.
Hello, I'm Johnny Cash.
It's rolling around the bend, and I ain't seen the sunshine. I don't know when. I'm stuck in holes of prison, and time keeps dragging on. Let that train keep rolling all down the side and tone. When I was just a baby, my mama told me, son, always be a good boy, don't ever play with guns. But I shot a man in Reno to watch him die. When I hear that whistle blowing, I hang my head and cry. Hey! There's rich folks eating in a fancy dining car. They're probably drinking coffee and smoking big cigars. Well, I know I had it coming. I know I can't be free. But those people keep a moving, and that's what tortures me. From this prison, if that railroad train was mine, bet I'd move it on a little farther down the line. Far from Folsom Prison, that's where I want to stay. And I'd let that lonesome whistle blow my blues away.
The only question Johnston had was, how long have you wanted to do this? I played Huntsville, Texas State Prison in 1956, and then I played a show at San Quentin Prison New Year's Day 1957. I said, I've been wanting to do it since January 1st, 57. Bob Johnston said, let's do it, let's go with it. So he set it up, in a matter of 2 months, we had done it.
The fact of not only an artist, but of a man, or any human being, that had to talk to people for 6 years at the point of what Johnny Cash was in 67 is bizarre and ludicrous. And I felt like crap like that ought to be changed. I felt it should be stopped. And hopefully I had a hand in helping along the way. All things like that should be stopped. An artist shouldn't be dictated to.
Bob Johnston was a producer that is an artist's dream. Bob Johnston likes to sit back and watch an artist produce himself, and then he puts it together. Bob Johnson is smart enough to know that when he gets an artist who believes in himself as an artist, to let him run with it.
I keep that blacktop guitar way up on the intro because that's powerful, the way that with the drums left. Don't you think, Bob?
Yeah. Be good.
Because when they come in, I can hear it. It's kind of a pleasant surprise, you know?
Yeah. I filled it up so you could have what you wanted to choose from. Yeah.
My drive was I knew I was involved in history and to become a part of it and hopefully to contribute and help like they were trying to do. I wanted to make it right for them. I wanted to make it better than any music that had ever been recorded or ever would be. I wanted each thing to stand alone on what it was, and I think they do. And whatever little I had to do with it, I feel really good about. This whole thing happened with Dylan, as it happened with a lot of artists, by a catalyst by the name of John Hammond Sr., who found such a multitude of artists that his list includes Dylan and Springsteen and the rest of them, and he actually began with Dylan. And when the Subterranean Homesick Blues, that thing, and it was great. John Hammond used to say, God, you know, we'd sit in there and listen to whatever it was with him.
He was a guy who was, you know, in his way a revolutionary. He was talking about race discrimination, which was a taboo subject. He was talking about war profiteers. He was talking about all the things that were no-nos that you couldn't talk about in the pop music business. But he talked about them, and he didn't like the people who controlled the industry in this country, and he figured I was an honest man, so he signed with me. He was known as Hammond's Folly on the label because they just thought he was absolutely crazy and there wasn't a chance for him to make it. As soon as I heard Dylan, I realized that he needed country background. He needed, you know, the kind of musicians we didn't have in New York. I mean, the kind of people who worked with people like Johnny Cash.
He and I were writing each other letters before we'd ever met. I got a letter from him saying that something like he was from Hibbing, Minnesota, and there was nobody out there but me and Hank Williams. And he was glad to hear about that part of the world that was out there, you know. And he kind of said that in his own words. The first time I met him was at the Newport Folk Festival in 1963. I was on the show with Joan Baez, Bob, and Ramblin' Jack Elliott. Then one night, Bob Johnston brought Bob Dylan to Nashville to do the Skyline album.
I don't ever remember anything happening with Dylan other than I always had every machine and everybody in the place and every engineer and some extra ones turning buttons on and moving microphones around to try to get whatever it was that he was coming with at the time. Because so much of the time, you never heard it again. He'd start a song and turn it around and then stop, or somebody would say something or somebody would make some noise or something, and that was lost, and then it was into another beat, into another song.
Is it rolling, Bob? To be alone with you, just you and me. Now won't you tell me true? Ain't that the way it
is? Bob and Sarah and the children stayed at my house while he was doing that album. And he asked me to be guest on it. Well, as it turned out, we went in the studio and they turned on the recorders for about 2 hours.
We set up some microphones and stools, and they came in there and met each other and went out there and started playing.
Take one, Johnny Cash, Bob Dylan, 1,000 miles behind. Take one.
You want me to get in closer on it?
History was happening. The evolution of social structure was being changed with this guy that came in the studio playing this music. And when Cash was combined with Dylan, each of them got a bunch of shares of different audiences, and all of a sudden it was fashionable for radio to play different things.
Down the street the dogs are barking and the day is getting dark. When the night begins to fall, then a dog will lose their bark. then a silent night will shatter from the sounds inside my mind. And I'm just one too many mornings and a thousand miles behind.
From the crossroads of my doorstep, my eyes, they begin to fade. And I turn my head back to the room where my love and I have laid. Then I gaze back to the street, the sidewalk, and the sign. And I'm one too many mornings and a thousand miles behind.
But it's a restless, hungry feeling. It don't do nobody no good. And everything I'm saying, you can say it just as good. 'Cause you're right from your side, Bob, but I'm right from mine.
I know it.
We're just one too many mornings and a thousand miles behind. They're right.
Down the street the dogs are barking, and the day is getting dark. As the night comes in a falling, those dogs will lose their bark. And the silent night will shatter from the sounds inside my mind. As I'm one too many mornings and a thousand miles behind. Just one too many mornings and a thousand miles behind. But just one too many mornings and a thousand miles behind. But just one too many mornings and a thousand miles behind. I'm just one too many mornings and a thousand
and a thousand
and a thousand
miles.
Another thousand,
thousand miles.
Yeah.
One that came out of that session was Girl from the North Country, which was a guest song on Bob Dylan's album. Bob Dylan's appearance brought a great deal of attention to Nashville, a lot of attention that a lot of my peers did not give him credit for, but still he brought a lot of attention on Nashville. People like him and people to follow who recorded songs in Nashville because Bob Dylan had.
The head of CBS's Nashville operation was in our office in New York one day, so I had him up to hear Bob Dylan, and as luck would have it, the session he came into, Bobby was singing about Oxford Town, which was Oxford, Mississippi, in which there had been a terrible lynching. And Bobby never pulled any punches, you know, in these things. And Don Law listened to him. He said, "My God, we'll all be run out of town if he comes to Nashville, John. I couldn't possibly take the chance."
And when he came to Nashville, he came, and it was history coming. Why the hell was Dylan in Nashville? Blonde on Blonde combined Memphis and combined the Southern Boys and combined a whole lot of things that roots of the actual people. That's what was happening. John Wesley Harding in the middle of rock and roll was three people. That's insane for business people or whatever. Supposedly, it wasn't insane evidently. I think that Dylan is the one that broke the door down to Tin Pan Alley, and I think he's the one that opened it up for Nashville. I think he should be given credit. I think for what he did with John Wesley Harding and Nashville Skyline, that he should be in the Country Music Hall of Fame.
Does he care about that?
It's probably the one biggest thing that ever happened to Nashville as a recording center of all kinds of music. Because after he came here, it was like people in the rock music field all of a sudden said, "Oh, wait a minute, Dylan went to Nashville, so it must be okay to go there."
There was an atmosphere of importance, I guess, to what was going on. To me, anyway, it was like Paris in the 20s. You know, it was just where everything in music was happening.
a true love of mine.
It was like my first week of work was when they came down and were making Blonde on Blonde.
And you're the only one
that was the only guy. I was the only songwriter in Nashville at the session. And I wouldn't have traded places with Kennedy. God, when you were sitting there talking about me coming in and making it in Nashville, I was just thinking about how I couldn't even have been a writer probably if it wasn't for a guy like Dylan.
The first time I remember seeing Chris, he was a janitor at CBS Nashville. And he was writing songs, and he was trying to get them to all the artists, you know. But he came to Nashville. You know, he was a Rhodes Scholar. He gave up a great career in a lot of directions he could have gone because he loved country music.
It was wintertime in Nashville, down on Music City Road. I was looking for a place to get myself out of the cold, to warm the frozen feeling that was eating at my soul, keep the chilly wind off my guitar.
Yeah, I was going to Newport Folk Festival again, and it was 65 or 66. I asked Chris if he would get to Newport some way and be my guest on the show.
I was scared to death, and I think he was. Too, because as I was going on the stage, he says, when you're singing in my house, he says, I can barely hear you, so try and sing a little louder.
But they said you stole the show from him.
Well, it went over like a star is born or something, you know. It was, of course, that was a hell of an introduction. You know, Johnny Cash was a dark, dangerous hero.
And here's another great innovator, Chris Christopherson, a man that did things that he wanted to do, and the way he wanted to do them got a lot of attention that way. There's still some great American heroes around like Chris, you know, that really pull it off, have a dream and run with it.
I saw there was just one old man sitting at the bar. In the mirror, I could see him checking me and my guitar. And he turned and said, come up here, boy, and show us what you are. I said, I'm dry. He bought me a beer. He nodded at my guitar and said, it's a tough life, ain't it? I just looked at him. He said, you ain't making any money, are you? I said, you've been reading my mail. He just smiled and said, let me see that guitar. I got something you want to hear. Then he laid it on me. If you waste your time talking to the people who don't listen to the things that you are saying, who do you think's gonna hear? And if you should die explaining how the things that they complain about are things they could be changing, who do you think's gonna care? There were other lonely singers in a world turned deaf and blind, who were crucified for what they tried to show. And their voices have been scattered by the swirling winds of time, because the truth remains that no one wants to know. Well, that old man was a stranger, but I'd heard his song before, back when failure had me locked out on the wrong side of the door. When nothing stood behind me but my shadow on the floor. And lonesome was more than a state of mind. You see, the devil haunts a hungry man. And if you don't want to join him, you got to beat him. I ain't saying I beat the devil, but I drank his beer for nothing. I stole his fucking song. And you still can hear me singing to the people who don't listen to the things that I'm saying, praying someone's gonna hear. And I guess I'll die explaining how the things that they complain about are things they could be changing, hoping someone's gonna hear. I was born a lonely singer and I'm bound to die the same, but I've got to feed the hunger in my soul. And And if I never have a nickel, I won't ever die ashamed, 'cause I don't believe that no one wants to know. Seems appropriate still.
It's more of a business, it seems like. It's always been a business, but it's more of a bigger business, and there's more people working at the record companies. More offices. It was a small two or three block area when I first went there with a couple studios. Now there's a lot of studios. And
you walk in and he used to say, listen to this, I got something, listen to this, and they'd all come around. Now you walk in and you have to have an appointment.
Yeah.
And you have to wait. Yeah. And you walk into this office and there's some guy sitting there, man. It's like that's what has happened. That excitement and that thrill of nobody really of there wasn't any precedence. We all did what we felt like.
Commercial was the dirty word in those days, because we couldn't get arrested. And so we thought everybody who was commercial had sold their soul, more or less. Soul was a big word in those days. And Willie was soulful, as Johnny Cash was. It was like, if you had soul, you were probably never gonna be successful, but you're gonna be true to yourself and true to your writing, you know? And, I mean, the guys were outlaws, just as Dylan was an outlaw. But didn't call them outlaws then. They called us outlaws later.
I really believe that the word outlaw came from someone who was trying to sell records. I think it was a commercial way to describe some people who were making music the way they wanted to make it. And I think that there have been people who have done that before, and the term outlaw just wasn't thought of at that time. Probably in the sense that of the term that they were using, what they considered to be an outlaw, I'm sure I was and still am. But an outlaw in the music sense, I think, is a person who wants to play his music and to write his music and perform his music the way he likes to do it.
Sure, Willie wanted to play music his way. It took him a lifetime of beer joints and highways, of honesty and determination, and breaking every rule for him to be recognized as the living legend he has become. And by doing it his way, he has shown that the only rule in music is that there are no rules, but the love and truth you put into it.
If I made you feel second best, girl, I'm sorry I was blind, but you were always on my mind. You were always on my mind. And maybe I didn't hold you all those lonely times. I guess I never told you that I am so happy that you're mine. Little things I should have said and done, I just never took the time. But you were always on my mind. You were always on my mind. Tell me. Tell me that your sweet love hasn't died. And give me. Give me one more chance to keep you satisfied. I'll keep you satisfied. I should have said and done. I just never took the time. But you were always on my mind. You were always on my mind. You were always on my mind. You were always on my mind.
I came to Nashville in 61, and up until then I'd been moving around over the country doing odd jobs and working in various nightclubs around the country, and a disc jockey and a salesman and what have you. It was my first opportunity to get to meet all those people in Nashville that I'd always heard about all my life, listened to on the radio on the Grand Ole Opry, and I got to meet them, I got to write songs for them, and it was very good time for me then, and I made a lot of very good friends there in Nashville during those years.
But Willie was known more or less by writers. He was kind of like a cult hero, and even his own record label didn't recognize who he was or his potential as an artist. They just more or less, I think, released records as a courtesy to him, you know, because they wanted him as a writer for their other artists. They put out albums, but they didn't market them at all.
It was not unusual for someone like me to kind of get pushed aside because things were going okay the way they were, and they didn't need somebody from Texas to come in and tell them how to handle the music business. So I'm surprised that I ever got started, really. And I don't think I ever would if I hadn't have gone back to Texas and more or less started over.
Whiskey River, take my mind. Don't let a memory torture me. Whiskey River, don't run dry. You're all I got, take care of me. Whiskey River, take my mind. Talk to me. Whiskey River, don't run dry. You're all I got, take care of me. Take my mind. Don't let a memory torture me.
Whiskey River, take my mind. Don't let a memory torture me. Whiskey River, don't run dry. You're all I got, take care.
Music is music. You just can't say, well, Nashville music is different from LA music or Dallas music, because it's, most of the time it's the same people playing, they're just moving from town to town. I don't really like to differentiate myself from those people, because we're all musicians trying to make it.
All of these people, it's like what they are troubadours. They're minstrels. You got to do something, you know, whether you're a cobbler, whether you're a carpenter. You can't just sit on your ass and not do anything. You got to do something. He plays. And he's got a lot of things in him to say, and he goes around and he plays.
It don't matter if those people in the business suits are controlling it, you know, or if they're sitting out there in the audience and not clapping, as long as we can keep doing what we're doing, that's all that matters. That's why I said, if whoever's going into Nashville like I was then, he's going in today, if he's going in for the right reasons, because he just got to do it, then he can't lose.
After all is said and done, people can make their speeches, they can write their things in the newspapers or whatever. When it's all is said and done, it's been the music, it's been the Beatles, it's been Elvis, it's been all kinds of people who have made major social changes because of the music.
And it is up to the innovators. It is up to the people who are going to keep, you know, being just coming with that new sound and that new music. If it is really good music, I believe, handled right, it's going to be successful.
But you got to start a few trends now and then. You need a Harper Valley PTA every once in a while. You know, you need a Heartbreak Hotel or something. And you don't do that by conforming and making records that you think the disc jockeys will play. You gotta do something that'll knock their hat in the creek, as we say, that'll surprise them very much. And that's hard to do.
You have something in mind?
No. I'll know it when I hear it, though.
It's just a matter of time, you know. Because I got some hell of a songs that people like to hear.
We need one more. Okay, roll tape.
Broken bottles in the alley, broken dreams among the shadows, the blood bank every Wednesday pays for 48 more hours near the mission there on 7th, where he never thought he'd be. On the other side of Nashville, Tennessee. There's a picker in the spotlight. like the picker in the crowd. But one is wearing rhinestones and the other's in the clouds. He's the one who came here starry-eyed, never thinking he would see the other side of Nashville, Tennessee. They told him go to Nashville when they heard him play so well. 18 and good looking with his whole life yet to sell. But now he's 45 years old and sleeping where he fell. He said he'd write from heaven, no one hears from hell. Every stranger getting dizzier and weak, just a song away from living where he wants to be, on the other side of Nashville, Tennessee. They told him go to Nashville when they heard him play so well. 18 and good looking with his whole life yet to sell. But now he's 45 years old and sleeping where he fell. Dreaming he's in heaven, waking up in hell. On the other side of Nashville, Tennessee.
Song.
I appreciate that.
Tell you what, anytime, brother.
I'll see you pretty soon. It'll probably be in the afternoon, I imagine.
All right, good. I'll be here. I'm working here.
Bill, good to see you.
It's like saying like you, I'd never get out of the bathroom, brother.
I'm gonna head out.
All right. Come back, sis.
Okay.
We'll catch you later.
Okay, bye-bye.
Bring that guitar back.
Okay. Bye-bye.
We'll see you. Y'all come back.
Dylan said, here's to the hearts and the hands of the men that are come with the dust and are gone with the wind. And a lot of times we wait to bury legends before we give them their just dues.
Well, it's one for the money, two for the show, three to get ready, now go, cat, go. You can knock me down, step in my face, slander my name all over the place. Do anything you wanna do, baby, lay off of them shoes. And don't you step in my blue suede shoes. You can do anything, lay off of my blue suede shoes.
car. Drink my liquor from an old fruit jar. Do anything you wanna do. Uh-uh, baby, lay off of them shoes. And don't you devil my blue suede shoes. You can do anything but lay off of my blue suede shoes. Let's hear some guitar song. Show. Free to get ready now.